Hello friends, today we will be doing with membrane proteins. So there are mainly two types of membrane proteins found in the biomembrane. What are the two types of membrane proteins found in the biomembrane? We all know this. Among this, the number one is intrinsic or integral protein, and number two is extrinsic or peripheral protein. Okay, now there are other types of proteins which are also found on the membrane. These are protein anchor proteins. So other types are protein anchor proteins and lipid anchor proteins. The ones which are anchored to the lipid and the ones which are anchored to the proteins on the membrane. Okay, so let's start one by one. We will discuss first with integral membrane protein. So integral proteins. So as I said, these integral proteins, they are embedded in the membrane. And these proteins, they are attached permanently in a biomembrane. Are you getting me? They are attached permanently in the biomembrane. So how will these proteins be separated if they are attached permanently? Question must be coming to your mind. How we will separate these intrinsic protein if they are attached permanently in the biomembrane? So they are separated by using non-polar solvents. It is very hard to separate the integral membrane proteins. They are separated only by these proteins are separated from membrane by non-polar solvents, denaturing agents, and detergents. Denaturing agents and detergents. So what I said, that these integral membrane proteins, they are embedded, they are intrinsic in nature, and they are attached permanently to a biomembrane, and it is very difficult for the integral proteins to be separated from the membrane. They can be separated by using non-polar solvents, denaturing agents, and detergents. Clear? So see the picture. So what is the structure of a detergent? A detergent is amphipathic in nature. That means it has both polar and non-polar ends. Okay, it has both hydrophobic tail and hydrophilic head group. Hydrophobic tail and hydrophilic head group, as we see in the double membrane structure of the living cell. Now see here. So if detergent is added to the membrane protein, what we see, that these detergent micelles or detergent monomers, when they are added together with the lipid bilayer having the membrane protein, then what happens? This detergent, it disrupts the lipid bilayer. This detergent disrupts the lipid bilayer. As a result of which, the integral protein and the lipid will dissociate from each other. So what we see, when we add the detergent micelle and the detergent monomer to the membrane protein in the lipid bilayer, what will this detergent will do? This detergent will disrupt the lipid bilayer. As a result of which, what we will get? We will get, see this light colored ones, these are the detergents. And this is a membrane protein. So this protein, there will be two complexes formed. One complex will be detergent, lipid detergent plus protein, and other complex is detergent, lipid detergent. Detergent is lipid in nature. Lipid detergent plus phospholipid. Okay, so I again repeat what I said, that whenever detergent micelle or detergent monomer is added to the membrane protein in the lipid bilayer, then what will happen? This detergent will disrupt the lipid bilayer. As a result of which two complexes we will be able to see? We will be able to see the protein, the lipid detergent plus protein. This is number one complex that we are getting. And number two is the phospholipid, which is solubilized by the detergent. Okay, when this detergent is bonded to this phospholipid, then this phospholipid is solubilized. Clear? So what we understood up to here is that it is very difficult to separate the integral membrane protein. They are separated by nonpolar solvents. They are separated by detergents. How will detergent separate the membrane proteins or the integral proteins? This detergent disrupts the lipid bilayer interaction and it brings this protein into the solution as a complex of lipid detergent and protein. Also, it solubilizes this phospholipid bilayer. This red colored phospholipid bilayer will be solubilized by the lipid detergent micelles. Understood? So now question must be there in your mind that what kind of detergent is used here. So the two commonly used detergent is SDS. Number one is SDS. The full form is sodium dodecyl sulfate. It is an anionic detergent. And another one is Triton X100. It is non-ionic detergent. Okay, this is the structure, SDS, and the another one, Triton X100, which is more complex than SDS. Now in this picture, what is shown that how a membrane protein is purified. So here the example is taken of Na+, K+, ATPase, which is an integral membrane protein. How this integral membrane protein is incorporated into phospholipid vesicle. So how this has been done? Up to here we discussed that when this detergent micelle or monomer is added, then there will be formation of two complexes. After this protein and detergent complex is formed, this complex is purified. After that, there will be the addition of new phospholipids which will be mixed with detergent. Okay, new phospholipid which will be mixed with detergents will be added. And the detergents which are already attached to the proteins, to the integral proteins, they are removed. Okay, what I said, that phospholipid added with the detergent is added and the monomers and micelles which are already attached to the protein are being removed in the purification step. Okay, after that, there will be functional sodium potassium ATPase which is incorporated into phospholipid vesicle. Clear? Next we come to integral proteins again. Now these integral proteins, they are also called as transmembrane proteins. Clear? So these integral proteins, they can be single pass or multi pass. Okay, they can be single pass or multi pass depending on the number of times they cross or they pass the membrane. Clear? So the protein which crosses single time a membrane is known as single pass, and this single passes membrane proteins, what is the structure of them? They have alpha helical structure. Okay, now, and if a protein passes to the membrane twice, it is double pass. And if it passes multiple times, it is multipass. Clear? So, a protein can pass either once or twice or multiple times through a membrane. So, this is how they are named: single pass, double pass or multipass. Clear? Next, we come to helix bundle proteins. Helix bundle proteins. So all of the membrane proteins, integral membrane proteins or say transmembrane proteins, they are, so maximum of the transmembrane proteins, they are helical structure. They are alpha helical structure. So these helix bundle proteins, they are present in all types of biomembrane. Okay, another one is barrel proteins. Okay, so these are beta barrel proteins, for example, porins. These beta barrel proteins, they act as a pore. Okay, they act as a pore through which molecules can diffuse from the outer to the inner or inner to the outer region. Through which molecules can diffuse. Okay, these porins, which are pore-like structure, they helps in passive diffusion. That means they act as channels which are very specific to different types of molecules. So they show passive diffusion, that means they act as channels. Okay, and what these channels are? These channels are specific to different kinds of molecules. Are you able to understand, guys? If yes, then please like and subscribe the channel. It will encourage me to upload more videos like this. Clear? So where are these porins found? So these porins, they are present in the membrane of gram-negative bacteria mainly. They are found in the membrane of gram-negative bacteria. Can you tell me one gram-negative bacteria? I'm sure everybody knows that. So it is E. coli, chloroplast. They are also found in the chloroplast. They are also found in some gram-positive bacteria, on the membrane of some gram-positive bacteria also. Also on this membrane of mitochondria. Clear? Now, one interesting feature which this E. coli have, that this E. coli have two membranes, outer membrane and inner membrane. These E. coli have outer membrane and inner membrane. Okay, the outer membrane is more permeable. Why this outer membrane is more permeable? What your logic says? Because this outer membrane have more porins. That is why the outer membrane is more permeable than the inner membrane due to the presence of porins. Now, what is the role of porin? You need to understand that. So, these porin proteins, they form aqueous channel through the lipid bilayer and helps in the movement of water and some small molecules through it. Okay, they form aqueous channel through the lipid bilayer. Clear? So if I draw the structure, how will the single pass and multi pass membrane protein will look like. So see, if this is a lipid bilayer, okay, if this is a lipid bilayer, and if a protein is crossing only one layer, okay, then this is called as integral monotopic protein. That means it is crossing only one bilayer, okay, one layer of the bilayer. If it is crossing only once, if it crossing both the lipid bilayer, then what it is known as? It is known as single pass. Okay, and if it's crossing multiple times, then this is known as multipass. Clear? Now we will discuss about integral monotopic protein now. Okay, so we are going to discuss about integral monotopic proteins. So already I told you in the last slide what are integral monotopic proteins. So these integral monotopic proteins, they attach to only one side of biomembrane, and they are not spanning both the lipid bilayer. So they attach to only one side of biomembrane. Okay, they do not span the whole lipid bilayer. So can you please tell me a few examples if you have already gone through this chapter? So example of integral monotopic protein is glycosylation and band 3 protein. So these are kind of favorite topics from where the examiner selects a question. Clear? So let's start with glycosylation. So this is an example of single pass transmembrane protein. I'm repeating again. So this is also an integral protein, but a single pass integral protein. Okay, where are they found? They are found on the plasma membrane of RBCs, and they are rich in sialic acid. Okay, so what is the role of this acid? This sialic acid, when it's present, it gives a hydrophilic charged coat to RBC. It gives hydrophilic charged coat to RBC. Okay, so what will happen if RBC become hydrophilic? If RBC have hydrophilic charged coat, this hydrophilic charged coat helps RBCs to circulate without disturbing the other cells. So I again write down, which helps RBCs to circulate without disturbing other cells. Here, these glycosylations, they are distributed in 5 types. Okay, they are distributed in around ABCDE is also there, but in some books you will find A, B, C and D only are there. A and B are antigenic determinant, C the function is not yet clear, and D have the structural role. Okay, now coming to another one, band 3. So guys, one thing here we need to correct, that this band 3 will be included under multipass transmembrane protein. Okay, will not include this under integral monotopic proteins. Clear? So band 3 will be included under multipass protein. So this band 3, which I said earlier that this is monotopic protein, But guys, this is multi-pass transmembrane proteins. It is having 14 pass. Okay, they are 14 transmembrane protein and they are encoded by the gene. I write here, they are encoded by the gene SLC4A1. The full form is solute carrier family 4 membrane 1. Okay, solute SL, solute C for carrier 4A1. Okay, they are encoded by SLC, solute carrier 4A1 family 4, SL solute carrier 4A gene. Okay, said to be a solute carrier family 4 member 1. Okay, 4 is family and 1 is member. Okay, in humans. Now, so these band 3 proteins, they are 14 transmembrane proteins and they are encoded by gene, I told you, solute carrier family 4 member 1, genes in humans. Okay, and these band 3 anion transport protein is also known as anion exchanger 1. Okay, I write E with capital. So it this band 3 anion transport protein, band 3 anion transport protein is also said to be as anion exchanger 1. Okay, what is the role of this band 3 protein? What is the role of this band 3 protein? They helps in many activities like protein anchor, transporter activity, like they help in the anion and cation transport, like sodium chloride and other anion transport. They helps in the regulation of intracellular pH. Okay, so this is it for today. We will continue with it in the next class. So before we end up, let's revise the most important topic of the today's class. So it is, there are 6 ways in which membrane proteins are associated with the lipid bilayer. Okay, there are 6 ways in which membrane proteins are associated with the lipid bilayer. Okay, so the most transmembrane proteins, they extend the both the lipid bilayer as a single helix. So this is the most common one where they cross the membrane or pass the membrane as a single helix, okay, or as multiple helix. Okay, here single helix. So the single helix and multiple helix, they are the most common ones. Now some of these membrane proteins, they have a fatty acid chain. They have a fatty acid chain which is inserted in the cytoplasmic monolayer. Okay, as you can see, it is inserted only in one layer. Okay, so it is inserted in cytoplasmic monolayer. This is very uncommon one where some of the single pass membrane have a cytosolic, have a fatty acid chain associated with the cytoplasmic monolayer. Okay. Now there are some proteins also which are attached to the membrane by covalent linkage. Okay. They are attached to the membrane proteins by covalent linkage, okay, via a fatty acid. So I write here by covalent linkage, okay, via a fatty acid chain or it can be a prenyl group through which these proteins will be attached to the lipid bilayer. Clear? And some uncommon linkage is this one also, number 4, where we see that this membrane proteins are attached to the lipid bilayer via an oligosaccharide. Okay? So they are attached via an oligosaccharide to a minor phospholipid. Now, what is a minor phospholipid? The minor phospholipid is, say, for example, phosphatidyl inositol. Okay, phosphatidyl inositol in the non-cytoplasmic side. Okay, so again I'll repeat that this is a cytoplasmic side and this is non-cytoplasmic side. This is cytoplasmic and this is non-cytoplasmic. Okay, so they are attached to the minor phospholipid in the cytoplasmic side. Okay, so I wrote opposite. It is non-cytoplasmic and this is cytoplasmic. Okay, so these lipids, they are attached via an oligosaccharide molecule to a minor phospholipid, say for example phosphatidyl inositol in the non-cytoplasmic monolayer. Is that clear right now? Now the last one is these proteins which you can see here, they are attached to the membrane by non-covalent linkage with other membrane proteins. Either on the non-cytoplasmic side, which is this one, or with the cytoplasmic side, which is this one. So that's it. We will continue with the peripheral protein in the next class. So if you like the video, please subscribe the channel. And if you have any query, you can freely write in the comment box. Thank you so much, guys. Wish you good luck.